morning. Okay. The scripture we'll be looking at now is in Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 6. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied."
Thank you, Tim. It's good to see everybody today, and thanks for all your participation in the school bags. These are going to teachers that are around the area. And we have picked out two of the poorer schools that are right close to us. And so those are the two schools that we're going to be taking bags to. As you know, we talked about the fact that, you know, if your kids come and help pack, then they got to take one. So we had a few kids come, and they were very excited to be able to do that. And so they were able to take one to their teacher. All of these are set to go to the school district. And it really helps us to be able to say, here's an influence we have in our world, and that we're trying to do something for them, and so we want them to know that we support them, that we are about families, that we are interested in children, and so that's one of those things that's very, very important. These are not for all the friends you know, just by the way, because it seems like everybody knows a teacher. Can I take one to my friend who's a teacher? If you want to do that, that would be great, but these are set to go to schools around here. So I would encourage you, make your bag, take it to your friend, tell them you support their friend, your friend, and that you want them to do a great job this year. And so this has been a good thing for us to be able to do and in reaching out to our community and letting them know that we are interested in them and that we're here for them. So the end of evangelism. I mean, this is part of evangelism. How do you do this? How do you influence somebody? How do you even get into a conversation? And so teacher bags are one way, perhaps, to be able to get into a conversation. We find that when we give the teachers bags that, you know, when we have an upcoming event like a harvest festival in the fall, they say, "Oh, sure, you can announce it here." Really? In a public school? Yeah. That's what this is for. That's what that does. This helps us get to people. Well, how does it normally happen that you get to people? Well, it normally happens that you get to people on their cell phone, right? I mean, that's what happens. We pay a lot of money to carry around these things so that telemarketers can call us. That's exactly how they get to us, and it's a very cold call. Usually anymore, it isn't even a real person. It's just a person. I mean, it's a recording of somebody who says, "Now, if you're interested in this, I want you to push one." Right. How successful is that going to be? Well, it might be really successful because they appear to call a lot. And if they didn't think it was successful, I'm sure they would have given up by now. But it seems like maybe we go about things the wrong way. And it seems like sometimes we don't see the real goal in mind. And so the only reason, their goal is money. I know they're not interested in me. It's a recording. You don't know anything about me. Usually because they're trying to sell me insurance when I already have insurance. I've told you I have insurance. I don't need insurance. And yet, you know, they're always doing this. So what happens with church? What's the real goal? Sometimes we decide, well, it's to get to heaven. Sometimes we decide the real goal is to have a bigger church. We need more people and more numbers so that we can have more people and more numbers. Isn't that the goal? I mean, it just keeps going. No matter how many you get, you need more people and more numbers so that you can have more people and more numbers. Well, when's the end of that? When's the limit of that? I don't see Jesus ever emphasizing numbers. It does not seem to be an issue. It's not that there's not a lot of things that were not done that have numbers. I mean, the feeding of the 5,000 and the, you know, things like that. It's five loaves and two fish. And so there are numbers that are all the way through Jesus' life. There's some very impressive numbers. But when he begins to start, the passage that was read to us in Matthew 5, he goes up on a mountain, he sits down, and disciples come to him. And he begins to teach them. And what he teaches them is not so much about, I want you to do this, and I don't want you to do that, and stay away from these people, and don't go near that situation. But he begins to teach them as followers. Here's what I want you to learn. Here's what I want you to know. And so as we watch how he does this, it's not so much a matter of him saying, well, learn these things and there'll be a test later on. He says, I want you to be these things. So when he opens his mouth, he says, blessed or humble are those people who are poor in spirit. They have the kingdom of heaven. And when we look at what he's really trying to get across, those who mourn, the meek, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, he says, not you ought to find that somewhere or buy some of that. It's, no, I want you to become that. I want you to become the people who are humble and meek and become people who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Because I think that's really what you want. He says those people are going to be comforted. They're going to be satisfied. They're going to inherit the earth and they're going to have the kingdom of heaven. Well, that sounds pretty good. And that's just in the first four. And so if you just do those, he says, do this and you get this. What an incredible thing it is. And that's what he's talking about with his disciples. It's people who follow him here in order to get there. And his main relationship, you realize, is always with disciples. And so he has a few friends like Lazarus and Mary and Martha, but then even those friends are disciples. They're people who follow. They're people who love him, but they also follow him. So in Matthew chapter 10, he called to him his 12 disciples, and he gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out, to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles were first Simon, who was called Peter, Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee, John his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. Isn't it interesting how he leaves the tag with them? Do we really need to know all the names of the 12 apostles? Well, it might help us in reading the New Testament to know who people are, but even as he gives us the list, he puts in Simon, who's called Peter, Judas, the one who will betray me, Simon the zealot. And he puts in all these different people as people who are his disciples. And he gives them authority. Yeah, he gives them authority over unclean spirits, over disease, over any kind of affliction, so that they are then able to heal all of those things. And he sends them out to be able to do that. He expects that of them. They know it's coming. He expected them to follow. He expected them to be able to accomplish the work that he would give them to do. And so when he sends them out, it's not about, well, I don't know. I'm not sure I can do that. I don't really want to do those things. Why don't you just give it all to Peter? He likes to talk a lot. Let's let him do it all. He expects them to go and preach. And that's what he had called them to do. And there are 12 apostles, all with difficulties. It's very interesting the way he does this. Why does he do that? I think it's so that people will see what it looks like. Here are people who follow me. It's a living example of what he's trying to say I want to happen in the church, in the world, whenever I'm not here. I want you to see that it looks like this. There are people who follow along after me, and they do whatever I say. What a concept. He says, this is exactly what it looks like. He says, I want them to be fishers of men. I want them to go out and to teach and to tell people. I want them to heal the sadness that is in the world from disease and from demons. He says, I want them to follow without any question. He didn't choose them because they're the greatest. Even though they argue among themselves about who's the greatest, none of them are the greatest. Because all of them had problems, and Jesus says, that's why I called you. It's because you're a great example of people who are so not special that I want everyone to know that if they see you, that they'll believe, well, if he can be an apostle or a disciple, then certainly I could do that. And he picks people who are just normal people, just like us. But he does incredible things with them. And we realize we can do this. The point of being a disciple is to carry on the work of Jesus, to bring Jesus to the world. But it's not a list of jobs or accomplishments. So the question becomes, when we look at us today, what is it that we've built? What is it that Jesus built? Does the success of ministry depend on the disciples we pick, or does it depend on God? Because I've seen a lot of churches that seem to sit here going, you know, if only we had, and they'll list somebody. If only we had people who were good at this. That's what we really need. We really hope someone will move in here who will be a good, and it doesn't matter what it is, a good servant, a good song leader, a good preacher. You always know it's bad when they're looking for a good preacher. But they're looking for somebody who would come in and do, you don't realize God's already given you all the people he expects you to need. That's who it is. And those are the only people you have, and other people can move in and join you, sure, but you're not going to wait until then to be able to do something. No, it's that all of us need to be true disciples. We need to really understand what this is about and what we're doing. So the success of what we do is not because we need somebody better. Why don't we have somebody better? Maybe we didn't do a good job of recruiting in the first place. We want the success to be in what we do, in our accomplishments. I'm not really sure it's there. When you look at what Jesus did, he spent time with the 12. He could have taught a whole lot more. I mean, he had crowds that were 5, 10, 15,000 people. If he just planned the venues each time, he could have taught a whole lot more. Instead, he spends time with the 12 in order to have maximum impact on them. And he really spends time with the 70 and the 500 and all of those around. And those are all numbers of people we see who are disciples of his. He could have made a video series, right? I mean, why didn't he wait till now and have a video? He could have written a book. Oh, wait a minute. I think that one's already covered. So why do that? Why have all that? Well, let me ask you maybe with this example. Why didn't you have 13 kids? I mean, just think about it. More family would be better family, isn't it? Isn't that the way we think? If bigger church is always better church, then bigger family would be better family. Follow? So 13 kids, they make 15 passenger vans. You can all ride in the same spot. I mean, you know, much more than that, and then it gets a little bit more difficult. But why didn't we? They used to do that. Back in the old days, people used to do that. And they all had farms, and they all needed workers. And so they raised their own. That's what they did. And everybody worked on the farm, and so maybe it's because we don't have farms. Is that why we didn't have that many? How big a table do you need? And when they all become teenagers, and you have 15 cars parked in front of your house, because they all have to drive their own, right? is family size really what you wanted when you started thinking about family? Is it about how you'll make an impact on the world? I think it's more that the kind of kids you have, not the amount of kids you have. Because it's about what you do with the kids that you have. It's not that more is better, it's better is the quality of the children you have. It's what you've put into them. It's how you've blessed them. It's all of the work that you've done with them, and it's what makes them better. A big number doesn't make a better family. A small number does not make a better family. It's how you train them and how they grew with you that matters, because you've made this great family. And if you had more kids, they would always be loved and they'd always fit in. So it's really not about size, but, you know, sometimes we do that. It's really more about this idea of making disciples. And that's, I think, what the point is. I'll find that slide yet. So maybe we start with our own children. That's what we're about, is about making disciples and being able to start there. When Jesus started making disciples, He didn't just take His own kids. He didn't have those. But we do. And we teach our children how to be disciples of Jesus. Jesus took His disciples and He challenged them. He showed them a transfiguration. Here's what I look like on a whole different level. Here's what happens. And He picked people who would go through a storm with Him. People who would watch Him walk on water and not all jump out of the boat and run away, but come to Him. He picked people who would outthink the problem. There's 5,000 men here. We don't have much. How would you feed them? And they panic and they don't know what to do until eventually they do figure it out and they say, you know what, this is like church. We only have this much and we can do that with it. And so you have to learn to outthink the problem. They find themselves casting out a demon from a man, and they can't do it. They can't figure it out. They don't know how to do it. Why can't we do this? And He says, your attitude's wrong. You need more prayer. It isn't a prayer you had to have said right before you said, hocus pocus, your demon is gone. It's that you didn't spend enough time in prayer, so your preparation for yourself isn't right. And He taught them how to deal with authority, and He taught them how to deal with power, and He taught them you have a limit. It's in how you go about it. It's in what you use, and God does all kinds of things to be able to accomplish this. So there are some things that Jesus built. One of the things He built is kingdom. It's allegiance to a king. It's people who are in His kingdom, and He talked a lot about kingdom because that's what they were looking for. They were looking for the kingdom of God. They were looking for the Messiah, the one who was to become king. And this had been set up for 1,000 years. Ever since David, the promise by prophets had been made that there would be a new king, that someone would sit on the throne of David and his kingdom would never pass away. And so this new kingdom was what they were looking for. And Jesus teaches them, you have a new kingdom. It's like a pearl of great price, that you would give anything for that in order to be part of that kingdom, or a treasure in a field, or a sower with seed. And there are things to be done in that kingdom. There are ways in which those people act. And what an incredible thing it is that He's able to teach that. He says, this kingdom is precious, and He came to begin it, and He came to build it. And today we are part of that kingdom because we take Jesus to be king. He is king in our life. It is what matters. But on the other hand, it's not a magical kingdom. It's not one that looks like this, that says, oh, eventually, someday, we'll get to the ivory towers. That place where there's streets of gold and there's walls of gold and everything is gold. It's just kind of monochromatic. He says, that's not what we came. He says, your kingdom looks more like this. That's where I reign, is among the people who are here. And I want you to realize that you are a person who worships and has allegiance to a king, and His kingdom exists in this world, and His kingdom exists among the people that you know. And this is where He reigns. us. And we are able to take that as Jesus reigning. He has power for people today. And sometimes we don't realize that, and sometimes we don't know that, or that they don't know that. But the kingdom of God is here. And Jesus already sits on his throne. When he ascended back to heaven, he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God, and he reigns in us on this earth right now. He built kingdom. And that's one of the things he was trying to build. And we see that especially as we look at what's going on in our world. He built kingdom, he built church, he built temple. Church is the fellowship of other people. Kingdom is people who take him to be king. And he talked about this future of the church that he would build as he talked to his disciples. I will build my church. We'll talk about that more next week. The other thing he built was a temple. And it's the group's relationship to God in worship. And so we'll talk a little bit more about that in another couple weeks. And you can see those are the three things that Jesus built. That's all Jesus built. He didn't try and build anything else. He did not build a help center for individuals. It's only those three things. But in those three things, you're going to find the help that you need. In those three things, you're going to find a way to live with God. In those three things, you're going to really find, here's what God expects and wants of you. So why does Jesus spend time with individuals if he's really trying to build a group? Because you have a lot of individuals named. Nicodemus and Bartimaeus and the rich young ruler and Zacchaeus and Lazarus and, you know, all kinds of different people. I think it's because of the way and the kind of group he was trying to build. That's what makes the difference. People that would give their life for him, not just people who said, well, you know, if we get time, we'll do a little bit of Jesus. It's people who would climb up in a tree with everybody else around to just get a glimpse of him. And he says, that's the kind of people I want. And the way he builds that is by spending time with those people. And so to build a group, he spends time with the individuals to make them into what he wants them to be. He calls them to be disciples. He calls them to be people who would follow him through a storm. He calls them to be people who would preach so hard that people would kill them for it. You look at those early disciples and you think, wow. So where are we? We build nice buildings so we can worship for an hour. We try and simplify it so much that it's really not so much of a big deal, right? We'll pretty much include anybody and everybody. Everybody's going to heaven. It really doesn't matter. We'll simplify it so much that, you know, if you just were baptized somewhere, anywhere, we don't care where, and if you show up once in a while, we're good. Does that sound like disciples? You don't have to give that much. You don't have to come that much. You don't have to sing that much. You don't have to pray that much. You don't have to study that much. You just have to not make waves. If you can just not make waves, then we're all good. No, I think his disciples were the ones who made waves. His disciples were the ones who made a difference. And we see it more as we compromise on everything. We compromise on worship for almost anything, even if it's just fun. Well, I needed a day off. Really? From God? Well, when else am I going to have fun? And the world has come to see us as a food bank, as a place to get money. I saw this. We aren't called to fill pews with members. We are called to fill the world with disciples. Sometimes I think we're on the wrong track. It is not about how many people sit in the pews. It is about the quality of the people who fill these pews. are these people who stand for Jesus Christ? What happened to the people who were converted in the New Testament church? They changed the world. And they started with 12. And it made a huge difference because of the dedication. We look around for leadership and see how many people are really leading other people currently already. And it's not very many. And I think maybe it's because we never really expected that. We never really expected ourselves to be disciples who have people who follow. That we are people who make disciples. That's kind of what Jesus wanted. What we really want is people who are going to live this stuff all week. People who are going to hunger and thirst for righteousness. People who are going to make a difference. We meet here, we get instruction, and we encourage each other all week. We can't wait for Sunday because we know about the praise. Because we learned it on Wednesday night. There's a new song. It's going to be great. It's going to be so good. And Michael comes in and does such a great job leading us. And the way all of you sound together, it's so encouraging and so uplifting. And we realize what kind of praise it has to God. And it's so incredible to hear all of those things and to be around people. And we encourage them and they lift us up. And we learn something from the study that we have. And we realize I can handle another week. And when people ask me about Jesus, I can tell them about Jesus. You see, when Jesus got to the end of his life in Matthew 28, let me start in verse 16. He says, now the 11 disciples, one's already gone, went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. I like the phrase, they worshiped, but some doubted. Because that fits us so much, doesn't it? Yeah, sometimes I come here and I worship, but man, I'm not sure about everything else. I'm not sure about a lot of things in life, but I believe Jesus is able to handle it. I believe that he has the answer for it. And some things are a struggle, and some things are a tragedy, and some things are going to be very difficult, and it makes it hard. And maybe that's where they were. They had watched Jesus die. And he expects him to just get over it. It's been almost 3 months. Come on. We've got work to do. We don't get over death so easily. I'm not sure about it. When the person gets back up, maybe it'd be easier then. But we don't just get over it in 3 months. But that's what Jesus says. Go make disciples. Open the word to the world. That's who we are. We are disciples who make disciples. And that's what he tells them to do. Teach them about being a disciple. Teach them all that he commanded. Teach them what happens. I don't think we would have a leadership problem at all. That there would be so many people who are in that position that are able to lead others if we just do this. If we become disciples first, people are going to want to know, of course, what are you doing? I can see your life and I can see how it's changed and I can see how you just seem to have a better way of living than anybody else. The end of evangelism is disciples, not church members, disciples. People who follow, people who do all that Jesus commanded. In the end of evangelism, the first step is to come follow Jesus. Because after all, that's what he says. So what does a disciple of Jesus look like? What do you think one looks like? Is there something you're not quite doing in that? Let me just challenge you this week to think about what a disciple really looks like. Is there something that in your life that says, well, you know, disciples don't do that, or they do this, or they do something better? Let me challenge you this week to be able to just think of one thing and say, all right, I'm going to start doing that. I'm going to do this because that's what disciples do. And Jesus has called me. The Son of God came down and talked to me and said, I want you to be my disciple. And that's what we do. Who do you trust to lead you? Who do you trust to follow you? Who trusts you to lead them? Do you have followers? These are hard questions for me. I don't mind telling you, these are really hard questions for me. But we only have one choice. Jesus had called us to follow. And so we follow him. And you can do that today. Absolutely. If we're able to help you do that, that's why we are here. To encourage, to uplift, and to help you be his disciple. Would you come while we stand and sing?